The most dramatic challenge to the American government came not from communists or political agitators, but from a ragtag army of former soldiers called the Bonus Marchers.
At the end of May 1932, nearly 10,000 Bonus Marchers occupied the nation's capital, and tens of thousands more were on their way.
Washington was under siege. The capital was surrounded by over 10,000 unemployed veterans of World War I from all over the country.
June 1989. For weeks, hundreds of thousands of Chinese students and workers.
Mass protests started off peacefully when hundreds of thousands of students occupied Tiananmen Square for 6 weeks in 1989.
The marchers had stayed, camped out in central Washington.
An enormous tent and shack city rose from the mudflats.
And camped out in Beijing's Tiananmen Square. Thousands of students and workers camped out on the square. Wild storms failed to discourage them.
By police count, there were still 11,698 marchers and their families in Washington.
There was a library in the center of it run by the Salvation Army. There was music day and night. There was gospel music, and there was blues music, and there was country music, and popular music.
The demonstration started to take the form of an outdoor rock festival.
But also it was almost joyous because the students were waving flags and the weather was good.
当时其实已经非常热了那个天气，但是呢一喊出来那个时候呢就觉得就是像那个喝了一杯凉水，喝了一杯那个特别那个痛快的那个从那个。
What the bonus marchers wanted was the premature payment of a bonus that they'd been promised, actual cash payment that they'd been promised in return as a thank you for their service in the military in World War I. This payment was due to be made in 1945. They wanted it now because they needed the cash, they said, not unreasonably.
I came to Washington to get my bonus, and I'm going to wait until I get it if I have to wait until 1945.
3 cheers for the bonus that we're going to get.
I think the word democracy misled a lot of overseas viewers. No, the students didn't understand that. To them, democracy just meant, you know, get off our back.
We probably don't know what democracy is leading in China.
I know who's made this country worth living in. It's just you fellas. Look, makes me so damn mad a whole lot of people speak of you as tramps. This is the greatest demonstration of Americanism we've ever had.
You start listening to the students' public speeches, and they were intellectuals.
Soon they started asking for democracy.
Also preparing for the Bonus Army was a prominent World War I veteran, General Douglas A. MacArthur.
The United States Army, through its military intelligence division, remained greatly concerned about the possibility of revolution. The Army developed a plan to defend the United States Capitol in the case of civil insurrection. And they were talking about using tanks, machine guns, gas.
By the time the Bonus Marchers arrived in Washington, the Army was more than ready to deal with them. The President ordered the evacuation of the veterans from downtown Washington.
Now there's been bloodshed. Now you bring in the troops.
When MacArthur moved his troops to the affected area,
He knew exactly what he was going to do. And he adorned himself in his dress uniform along with his major aide, Dwight D. Eisenhower.
The force stepped off at 4:30 p.m. More than 200 cavalrymen spread out across Constitution and Pennsylvania avenues. Behind them came 400 infantrymen, followed up by tanks and armored vehicles.
The cavalrymen, one of whom is Major Patton, have got their sabers out.
The soldiers donned gas masks and, without warning, began hurling gas grenades at the veterans. The troops advanced, some jabbing with bayonets.
Many did not believe that United States troops would take the field against them.
By early evening, most of the marchers had been driven across a drawbridge that led to their main camp. All through the camp were scenes of panic. Then troops began to set fire to their wooden shacks.
And so they're being forced out of their shacks by smoke bombs and tear gas, hurled by the troops who have been called out by the President of the United States. And the roaring flames sound the death knell to the fantastic Bonus Army that ends so disastrously in the shadow of the capital of the United States of America.
Rather than turning the population against the students, the editorial had the reverse effect. In support of the students, policemen, journalists, government workers, and even some members of the armed forces joined the peaceful protests. They ignored his plea to end their action.
And talked to them, shook hands, and the soldiers really were quite confused. So the martial law, I called it marshmallow law, because nothing happened. And that was a big humiliation for the Communist Party.
After 3 days, the soldiers retreated to the outskirts of Beijing. The protest continued for another 11 days. Then, on June the 3rd, 1989, Deng Xiaoping gave the order to clear the square.
His orders to the troops were contradictory in one sense. You have to clear the square by 6 a.m., no matter what. On the other hand, please, no bloodshed. Well, for the soldier, of course, you can't do both of those.
Suddenly, the military was coming in from different parts of the city, all four corners of Beijing. They were marching in. And there were tanks and armored personnel carriers. The tanks came roaring in, and people tried to stop them by putting a city bus perpendicular to block the road. And I saw the tanks just smash into the bus. I saw this guy, young man in a white shirt, holding some bag, and I thought he's going to get squashed because they had run over people. And then you see the tank actually twist to one side to go around this nutty guy, and the man jumps in front of him. And then the tank goes the other way, and the man jumps in front, and then the tank stops onto the tank. And I go, are you crazy? Are you nuts? And he seems like he wants to talk to the people inside.